Thank you. very unique combination of experiences that she's had. And when I was interviewing for my job at Thomas Nelson, she told me she had been a Head Start teacher. And I thought, what an interesting background for someone to begin in an early childhood field and to work your way up to being the president of a community college. So let me just tell you a little bit about Dr. Pippins and why I'm so happy to have her here today. Dr. Pippins is the president of Thomas Nelson Community College. She assumed that role in February of 1995. She's the fifth president of our college, the first woman president of our college, and the first African American to lead the college in the 32-year history that we've had. Dr. Pippins earned her doctorate at Columbia University and has completed studies at Harvard University's Institute for Educational Management. She received her bachelor's degree from the University of Illinois, where she graduated as a member of the Phi Beta Kappa National Honor Society. She also holds master's degrees from the University of Illinois and from Manhattanville College in New York. The other information I think you would find interesting is that she's the mother of three children, as I am, and as Teresa Frazier is. So we've all been there needing childcare, and we all need you desperately. So please help me in welcoming Dr. Shirley Pippins. Good morning again.
Good morning.
And I thank you for giving me this opportunity to be part of your program. I do come to this meeting this morning with three different perspectives. The first has already been mentioned, that is of the parent, as a parent of three children. One is 26, so I can no longer tell my children I'm 25.
Thank you.
challenging, supportive teachers. It will have childcare workers who are loving and who are flexible and who won't die if your mind is late. It will have spiritual and religious leaders. It will have pick-uppers in emergencies. It will have relief workers who will give you a break on a weekend night or on a weekend. It will have takers. It will have volunteers. It will have people who will give you a second chance. It will have co-workers and teachers who will let you be a parent who's a very strong teacher. When we as mothers look at you as part of our village, it's important that you remember that we're scared. We're scared about psychological abuse, molestation, physical harm coming to our children. We're scared about our children not getting enough attention. We're afraid that maybe we can't juggle all these things that we're trying to do. We're afraid that we'll miss those special moments like those first steps or those first rows. And we're afraid that you will steal our children's hearts. I remember those critical moments, I guess now 27 years ago, when I looked for my first child care provider. And I remember walking, I can still see this, into a home that had been highly recommended to me and being taken into a basement where there were just rows and rows of playpens. And walking away from there and thanking God that I could say no and realizing that He's given a lot of mothers had no choice. I remember interviewing people with references who were clearly dysfunctional. I remember the year that I had three child care babysitters in 1 year. I remember these women. One was a wonderful woman. Her son's ex-wife just dropped the three grandchildren in her yard one day. She couldn't take care of my children anymore because she had to take care of her grandchildren. And the next one was a wonderful woman who was overweight and had a bypass operation, and somehow they didn't discover that she was pregnant. I went to Washington, D.C. for a meeting one morning, and my ex-husband called me and said, I've got a surprise for you. Barbara had a five-month baby. And then there was Mrs. Guthrie, who stayed for a while. You can imagine what that felt like for me and my children to go through that transition. I remember taking my youngest to a family daycare mother and almost dying of guilt and worry, and being comforted only because that family daycare mother was a mature woman, a member of the community, a member of my church, and somebody that my friends also knew. You at your very best resolve all of these issues for us. You give us comfort, you give us the peace, you give us the space and support we need to be all that we can be. And in many ways, you are the true liberators of women, because without quality child care, there is no liberation for mothers. We often look to you for validation of our themes of child care. You know that the best preparation for adulthood, and somewhere I've read that in a world childhood book, the best preparation for adulthood is a good childhood. You know that making life hard and tough for children does not prepare them for a hard life as an adult. You know that loving and sensitive care, meeting the needs of children, makes them and prepares them for adulthood. Because children are, and they become, what they live and what they see. The Bible tells us that we train up a child in the way that he or she should go. The converse is also true. We train them in the way that they should not go. They will continue in that direction. Training comes in many surprising forms. Big feet, little feet, pitter-patter feet, they're watching. Let me just share two powerful examples with you. A dear friend of mine, Joan Wilson, went back saying in my inauguration, she and I were in South Africa, I guess it was about 9 years ago now, and Joan was a professionally trained operatic singer, and we kept trying to get Joan to sing to the children. And finally, she sang Summertime from Porgy and Bess. And those of you who know the song, at the very end, it's a beautiful, powerful high note. Joan sang that song, hit that note, and the room was just silent. And then finally, the children burst into applause. And later, as we started to walk away back to our car to move around in South Africa, we heard one of those children just hit that note. And we knew that forever that child's life was changed. The options, the view of the world had changed. The second experience was also in South Africa. We were there for about 3.5 weeks, and at the very end, the last day, there was a conference. And it
was for blacks and whites and colored and Indians, and I could never tell all these people apart. I think I was a colored in South Africa, can't figure it out. But that last day, we were walking around, and two Pakistani Indian young women came up to us and said, "You don't know, but we've been watching you. And when we grow up, we want to be just like you." Now, we didn't know that just the way we carried ourselves and the way we talked and the way we presented ourselves, we set a model for them that they had been watching. There are other important messages that we send children through the slogans we use. My mother was fond of saying, "Prepare for the hope for the best and prepare for the worst." And I just thought that was horrible. But we say a lot of things to kids and they remember them. And I have to thank Donna D'Amelio and Debbie Belcher in the English department for finding the source of this saying. But there was one I saw a lot in South Africa. It was an ancient Persian saying. It said, "I wept because I had no shoes until I saw a man who had no feet." Now there's much value in a saying like that, because it teaches us not to feel sorry for ourselves. But the other side is that it can also teach us to accept less than we might have. Consider, for example, the impact on children if the saying read, "I wept because I had no shoes until I learned that Imelda Marcos had 100. Very different. "I wept because I had no shoes until I saw a man that could own them." Another feeling. "Or I wept because I had no shoes until I saw my mother work and save $5 a week until she could buy me a pair." These sayings are powerfully different. They expose children to vastly different views of the world, and heard over and over and over again, they create a vastly different experience for children. There are other types of powerful messages. We all know not to scream at children, not to be mean to them, not to tell them they're stupid. But reflect with me for a moment on the powerful messages we send children by the choices we do and do not give them. As I mentioned to you when I started out, I worked with Head Start and Follow the Models. And my sights ranged from what was then the poorest county in South Carolina to a very wealthy county in Chicago called the Gold Coast. Now, in both sites, the children were taught exactly the same content. But in South Carolina, the children had reading at 8:30, at 9 o'clock they had language, and at 9:30 they had math. On the Gold Coast of Chicago, the teacher said, "Good morning, boys and girls. What would you like to learn first today? Would you like to start with math, or language, or reading?" And they could start at any table they wanted, and they knew that in the course of that experience, they would learn all of those things. Now, those teachers, as you are, just by the basis of the choices they offer, either create leaders, or they create followers. Choices create leaders. And when you actually think about it, it is almost frightening how powerful the roles that you play are. Through your work and what I like to consider your mission, you truly are your brother's keepers and certainly your sister's keepers. Without you, we can't work because we can't have the peace, the comfort, the focus, the lack of guilt that we need. Without you, we can't raise healthy, self-confident children. Without you, we can't raise reflection, I realized that I actually owe these people my very livelihood, and I ought to express that. So here it goes. Every mother who is employed outside the home eventually finds herself in a conversation about childbearing, about what's best, or at least selfish, for the wife. Often there's an implication that the mother must have to work, of course. If she didn't have to, then she would be home with her children all the time. There's an implication that we working mothers are not full-time mothers just because we're not there with our children 24 hours of the day. But that is an unproductive and inaccurate characterization. Parents do in fact choose to pursue a career for a myriad of reasons, not just because of financial need. In most cases, as recent research is showing, career success makes us happier and healthier individuals and therefore better parents. But the absolutely critical part of this choice is the availability of outstanding childcare for our children. Successful parents partner with their childcare providers so that they do in fact have full-time influence over their children's upbringing. Childcare providers enhance a child's growth and development because their experience and knowledge can introduce the opportunities a first-time mother might not even be aware of. My 4-year-old daughter is an outstanding example of childcare provisions, which we have enjoyed since she was 3 months old. Her centers have given a great source of stability and stimulation for her. And I realize that although I personally have given her a great deal, she would not be the wonderful, articulate, happy, sociable, bright little girl she is if she hadn't had the breadth of experience that her childcare experiences have provided. Childcare has been an integral part of our family, and I celebrate these professionals for what they do, not only for children, but for the families in our society. And she closes by saying, "See you in the morning, Sally." That's Sally over there in the back, and they're living here somewhere. So with those comments and those thoughts, I close this morning, and I wish you a happy and productive day. Two classes a semester,
Number is 56034.
Goodness.
Number three, Cassie. 256023. 256085. 256085. 256095. 256029. 256024.
All right.
256035.
All right.
That's why it was in the back. 256110.
All right.
256087.
What about our set?
256003.
I put on that set.
256049. 4941.
All right, front, front set, yeah.
And this is for the hair student, hair at last.
Oh, girl, go get the hair, get it, all right.
Okay, now for the feet. For the feet, 256009.
All right.
And this is the last one, 256006. What we're going to do is take a little break. People who are employed at daycare centers will come back into this room. People who work at family day homes will go out back into the lobby, go out the front door that you came into, and follow the little covered walkway all the way to the end, and you're going to see a telephone there. Make a right, and you're going to see the little pitter-patter feet up on the door, and you know you're in the right door. Go down that hallway to your left. There's an auditorium door that's open. It has a little pitter-patter feet on it, and you'll go in there. Then you'll have a break after your first session, and then you go into your second session, and you meet back at the same places. At the end of the training today, come into the lobby, and we're going to have your training certificates separated by your last name. Some of you, I think, we had a very hard time reading your writing. So what we're going to do is tell you that if we misspelled your name, come see one of us. We'll be sitting there with some blank certificates, and we'll issue you one with your correct spelling, okay?
I wanted to invite you to look at the displays that we've set up. All the materials out here are things that our students have made in the course of taking different early childhood classes. They're precious to us, so they're not to leave this room. So they're not for taking home as samples. These are all things that need to stay here. We also put out a lot of our student projects and some of the textbooks and resource books that we use. But all of those do need to stay in the room. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
There's one right on here.